this week for the message. We're just taking a break from 2 Samuel because it's a Servant Appreciation Day. We thought we would rather focus the message in a whole different area and have appreciation for the servant ministries that we have and why we do those servant ministries. Now, the scripture that we have this morning, the Bible reading, is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 21, and it's in page 1230 in your pew Bibles. So if you'd like to turn there and we'll read this through. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us of his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Saviour of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this command: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. Sorry, I'm sure in that I missed out one line in the Bible reading. In my early adult years, a young man attended youth group one evening. His background had been very difficult, and it resulted in a lot of problems for this young man, including a really poor self-image and a severe problem with stuttering, making communication for the young man almost impossible. It was one of the worst cases of stuttering I have come across. We felt really sorry for him, and we felt really sad for him. And we talked about it over the next few weeks, but that was of no help to him at all. Our feelings for him weren't going to help him at all, until we decided to put our feelings for him into action. So from that time, we paid regular visits to him. We invited him to all of our meetings. We held a youth group barbecue in the yard next to his flat, and we embraced him fully into the youth group. In essence, we simply loved him with Christian love. We didn't just feel sorry for him, but we actively loved him with Christian love. After a while, this is the amazing thing, after a while we noticed that his stuttering started to become a little less. And then as we watched over the coming weeks and months, his stuttering kept diminishing until he could talk to us with hardly any stuttering at all. And the amazing thing is his countenance changed. He grew in confidence. And now, instead of a sad look, there was just so often a smile on his face. This is love in action. We will see today from the Bible that God's love is much more than just a feeling. It is incredibly and amazingly active. And it is the reason for the ministry that we see here at MPC. God's love in action, shown through you, results in so many being on rosters, being in leadership of different kinds, and in caring for each other. We're going to see now up on the slide in verse 7, we are told, love comes from God, and everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Therefore, to understand love, we need to look to God and to know God. Many people focus their attention elsewhere to try to understand love. They might look to the movie screen, or they might look in the magazines that you find at the checkout on the way out of the supermarket, or they read romance novels, or they look at articles on the internet, or now so much of Australia is trying to find the meaning of love watching Bachelor every Wednesday and Thursday night during the week. But if that is the sum of our wisdom on love, we have missed the most important point, that love comes from God. And the Bible goes even further. Not only does love come from God, we are told in verse 8 that God is love. Now, God did not find love out in space. He didn't find it behind a huge gas cloud or a spiral galaxy. God didn't decide one day that love was a great concept that he found somewhere and decided to take it to himself. There is not God and love. God is love. And that impacts greatly on how we love. For in verse 16 we read, God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This means just as God is love, when we live in God and he in us, love is a part of us. It is not an optional attachment. We don't go looking for love. It is in us through God. Love isn't a church department that we choose to belong to for a certain time in our church ministry. Love is our Christian service, and it's our Christian service all of the time. We can't opt into love or opt out of love. Love is integral to who we are because we are in God and he's in us and God is love. Another New Testament verse, Romans 13:8, says this, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. In other words, we can't pay love off. We always owe love because God is love, and in him, love is a part of us. Sometimes I hear people say, over the years I've heard it, and they've said, oh, I've done enough loving, I'm going to have a break now and let other people do it. But the Bible says, no, you can't do that because love is us. God is in us. Love is us. It's not something that we can opt out of. Now, if love is part of us because of who we are in Jesus, what should love look like in our life? We have it, but how does it work? We find the answer in God himself. God, who is love, shows us how to love. So we read in verses 9 and 10. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. God shows us that his love is more than just a warm feeling. God demonstrates his love practically. He puts his love into action. God shows his love through sending Jesus to die for us on the cross for the forgiveness of sins. God's love is much, much more than just a warm feeling, though there is feeling in God's love. But a warm feeling doesn't help us. It is imperative for God's love to be active, to be of benefit to us. Warm feelings can't save us, but active love can. Warm feelings can't save us, but Jesus dying a substitutionary death on the cross certainly can. In verse 11 we read, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Or can I just paraphrase that verse a little bit and put it like this? Since God so loved us in action, we also ought to love one another in action. God's love through us is so much more than just passive love. It is proactive love. It is much more than warm feelings. It is love in action. Most people in the community will say that love is important. Very few people in the community will argue about it. Most people will say that love is important. But most people tend to think of love as a feeling. But to feel and not act is of no use. God's love acts. A long time ago, a man wearing a black coat and a black Akubra hat started to attend our church. The hat and coat were covered in all kinds of badges. There were no empty spaces anywhere. Can you imagine a coat and a hat completely, totally covered in badges of all kinds? It was very colourful. But what we found out after talking to the man for a while is that it was actually a loud cry for attention and help. What we decided to do was to actively embrace this man into our church. We included him in every possible way. As we gave him unconditional love, we noticed one day a few black spaces on his coat. And we marvelled at it and we thought, he's taken off some of his badges. And over the coming weeks and months, we noticed that more and more badges were coming off his coat and hat, until in the end, he only had a few badges left, like would be normal probably for anybody wearing a coat. He didn't need to cry out for attention or help anymore. God's love in action started to bring healing, and he accepted Jesus as his saviour. The church family here at MPC recognises the truth that God's love is active. It recognises that to sit at home and feel warm feelings for people is of no help. To sit at home and feel warm about MPC services or MPC growth groups is of no help. Love is only helpful when it becomes active. Now have a look at this fellow. Some of you would remember Norm from the Life Be In It ads. Now if you're a little bit younger, you may have missed it on telly, so I'll just explain it very briefly. For several years, there was an advertising campaign called Life Be In It, and the whole point of it was to encourage people to be active. In some way, just get out and do something physical, because of course it's a far healthier lifestyle if you can be active. So the whole ads revolved around that. But one of the key characters was dear old Norm. And you can see him there, and he's sitting on his couch. He's got his beer can on his pot belly and he's watching TV. And of course, what is he watching? He's watching sport. Now, Norm loved his sport. But the problem is he never actively participated in it. He loved sport from his couch. He was one of those people that watches sport on TV and was probably the greatest expert. He was probably one of those people who sat there telling the players how they ought to play and what they were doing wrong. But he always watched it from the comfort of his couch. God doesn't want spiritual norms who love him from a distance or who love his church from a distance. God doesn't want spiritual norms who have warm feelings about him or who have warm feelings about the church but never actively help out. God wants us to fill rosters and to participate in groups and to care for people. And that is what we see here at Mitchie, love for Jesus that outworks in serving him. I believe that's why we have such a great uptake in service here, as we saw earlier from the stats, because people here love Jesus, and the expression of that love is that they actively want to serve him. I used to argue with this man in church, and it was a nice argument, though. It was a gentle argument. The reason I argued with him, because this man, for years, every Saturday morning, would spend 2 to 3 hours cleaning the church auditorium, cleaning all the adjacent rooms, and cleaning the amenities block. And why I used to argue with him, I used to come and say, it's not fair, we need to have other people helping you to do it. You shouldn't have to clean the church building all on your own. So we used to have these little arguments, but he insisted that he would do it and would be very upset if we included anyone else on that particular roster. And this is what he said to me. He said, I love Jesus and I know that Jesus loves me. And I can't preach a sermon on Sunday. I don't even think I can lead a growth group. But one thing I can do, I can come down here and I can clean the church. And he said, you know what, Pastor? When people come on a Sunday and there might be visitors coming and maybe they're coming with an emptiness inside and they're coming searching for answers, maybe they're coming searching about this fellow called Jesus. Well, if everyone's doing their job, if people are preaching, if the musicians are doing their job, if the stewards are on the job, but the person looks around and they see a nice church and everything's in place, then it is going to help them to feel like maybe they can stay, maybe they can come back again. And it just might happen that that person might come to know Jesus as their Lord and Saviour. They may become a follower of Jesus. And he said, that's why I want to clean the church. Well, how can you argue with that? But I believe that's the heart that I see here at Mitchie. It really is. A whole group of people, a church family that just says, I love Jesus and I want to serve him. You know, we can love in, you know, major ways. Maybe it might be years and years of service. It might be people who are serving on umpteen rosters. Or sometimes love might just be something that's really simple. You know, I can't help but often thinking when we come in and several people get around and put up that visitor tent outside, it's just a small act of service. It's a small act of love. But how do we know? What if somebody's come into church and they've come in seeking answers and they have a great service afterwards, they go out to the visitor tent, get a lovely cup of coffee from our famous baristas, and somebody engages with them and they have a meaningful conversation, and out of that they say, I'm going to come back again. I'm going to keep coming back. And they become a follower of Jesus. You know, every little act that we do of service, sometimes we might think it's even inconsequential, but we just don't know when we serve God the impact that that might have in the whole flow of things. In verse 12, we read, "No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us." If no one has ever seen God, how can we ever know him? Well, what we do know is that Jesus has revealed God to the world. And when we love one another through Jesus, the invisible God reveals himself to others through us, and his love is made complete. His love is complete when it moves beyond a warm feeling. It is complete in action, the action of Jesus and the action we display. If we hold back, love remains incomplete. Love can only be complete when it emanates from the giver and it is received by somebody. But if we hold back, if we don't give love, then love remains incomplete. And therefore, in verse 21, we read that God has given us this command. Anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. The amazing Almighty God has chosen to love us through Jesus and then partners with us in loving others, so his love is made complete. The Almighty God, who can look behind galaxies, who knows all things, who makes the sun rise, he partners with us in sharing his love. And he not only does it through the great and powerful, he shares his love with and through those of the simplest means. Remember Jesus, who is watching people give the temple offering, and a lot of people came along giving a lot. And then the widow came along and she put money in and it only amounted to a few cents. You know, the type of person, we wouldn't invite her to the fundraising dinner. We wouldn't think she was important enough. And yet Jesus commended her for her love. He said she has given everything. And this amazes me about our Almighty God, who even shares his love with the simplest and the weakest. No one misses out. No one is unimportant. Our amazing Almighty God sits in the dust with his children and he says, "I'm going to share my love through each and every one of you." How special that is. What a privilege it is. In this verse, we see that we are commanded to love. And sometimes people look at it, at the word a command, and they think, oh, that's just a rule. A command, that's something harsh. A command, God's just punishing us. He's just saying, you go out and you love. You know, we can take it like that. But no, that's not the case. Because you see, God is love and love is good and God is good. And when God tells us to love, it's not him being harsh or it's not him getting on our case. It's God actually saying, I am going to partner with you in sharing my love with other people. Friends, that is an amazing and awesome privilege that God gives to us. Love is not something to think, oh no, not just another thing to do. But if we see it, that we've got the privilege of sharing with God, it changes the whole perspective. And God helps us to love. In today's passage in verse 13, it says this, "He has given us of his Spirit." And another New Testament verse, Philippians 2:13, just sheds a bit more light on that. It is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfil his good purpose. We are not alone. The Holy Spirit helps us to share God's love. So we shouldn't strive to do it on our own, in our own strength. But let us stay close to God, to rely on God's guidance, his wisdom and his strength. When we strive to get the job done, when we are driven to do it for the wrong reasons, it becomes tiresome and the joy leaves us. Have you ever been there? When you just feel this is just a chore? I feel weary. I'm not joyful about it. When we do it relying on God, the outworking of his love is beautiful. It is warm. It is healing. And we are filled with joy. And let us remember that at times Jesus in his ministry grew weary. But you know what he did? He withdrew. He went to the quiet, lonely places and he spent time with the Father. And if we're serving, being guided by God, we too need to at times withdraw into the quiet and lonely places and spend time with God. And what's more, we need to see that in each other. And we need to encourage in each other. We need to be saying to each other at times, hey, you look a bit weary. Why don't you withdraw? Why don't you go and spend some time with the Father? Now, if the Holy Spirit helps us and he is in us, we should help each other to love and encourage each other. And that's what this Appreciation Day is about. It's to say thanks and to encourage each other in serving the Lord. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 and 25 says this, "Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, encouraging one another." You know, encouragement chases away weariness. It makes the task lighter. On the day I left the government department I was working in to go and go to Bible college, the manager of the department came to me and he said, "I'm sad to see you go because you are a really fine officer." It took to the last day after 3 years for him to come and give me some encouragement. And I would have loved to have some encouragement during the time. I didn't know whether I was good or whether I was bad or whether he loved me or whether he disliked me. And it would have been nice to get some feedback. But it was only on the last day that he said that I was a good officer. Let's not wait for somebody to have a funeral to say nice things about them. Let's do it now. Let's make that a culture of MPC, that we're full of thanks, that we're full of encouragement. Let's go to our growth group leaders and say, "You are doing a great job. Thanks for your service." Let's go to our musicians and say, "Thank you for the time and effort you put in." Let's go to the guys in the sound room and say, "Hey, thank you guys, because they don't just come here on a Sunday. They put in work before they even get here." And friends, we could go on and on through so many jobs and roles in this church. Let us encourage one another. Let's thank each other. Let us be very slow to criticise and to tear down, because that's a destructive force. But let us be quick to encourage. Let us be quick to thank. Let us really energise each other and lift each other up. And if we serve that way, it's God working in us to help us to love. And in closing, on behalf of the elders and staff, can I say again to you, thank you for your love for Jesus and the way that you work out that love in practice through serving him. Michi is a great church because you know God's love in your heart through Jesus, and in turn, you put God's love into action. Thank you so, so much.